Hey ladies, welcome to the next AndEngine tutorial. I always say hey guys, so I thought I'd mix it up and give a shout out to all the ladies watching these tutorials. So all three of you, welcome to the tutorial. Everyone else, thanks for watching as well. In this tutorial, I want to briefly talk about where to start because it seems like there's a lot of confusion in the AndEngine forms, and there's a bunch of different examples, and each example shows a different class extension or superclass. So what I want to talk about in this tutorial is the differences and why there's confusion. So in the first version of AndEngine, the GLES1, you would extend base game activity. So that's one of the options that you'll see. And base game activity in GLES1 is completely different than base game activity in GLES2, which is what we're using. So that's one reason why people get confused, because they're completely different classes. They have different methods that you have to implement, and obviously that caused confusion. The other class that you'll see often is simple base game activity. And again, Control Shift O is to add your imports, and we need to add some methods here. The simple base game activity in GLES2, the version that we're using, is pretty much the exact same as base game activity in GLES1. So people that are transitioning from the old version of AndEngine to this newer version of AndEngine, they'll probably want to use this simple base game activity because it's pretty familiar to the base game activity in GLES1. What we're actually going to do is we're going to use the new base game activity for AndEngine. And actually, before I talk about that, the simple base game activity, how this would work if you guys are wanting to do the simple base game activity, which I will not be using, but if you do want to use this, how this works is it will call these three methods automatically. You won't have to do any callbacks. It will load up your engine options, which we'll explain what that is in a second. Then it'll load up your resources, and then it'll create your scene. These three methods will get called automatically in order, kind of like in our Android development when the onCreate would get called, then the onResume, and etc. But with the difference with the GLES2 version of base game activity, I'm going to add my import there. The difference is, let me delete these out, is that you have to do the callbacks yourself. So once you're done with one of these methods, you want to say, hey, I'm done doing this method, you can do something else. So what this allows us to do is have a lot more versatility in our application, because we can call a different method or load a different scene before we want to maybe populate the scene or something like that. You can have a lot more versatility, but you also have to remember to say you're done with each method when you're done. Okay, so hopefully that makes sense, clears up some confusion. So if you guys are doing a search for base game activity examples, make sure it's GLES2, the second version of AndEngine, or the updated OpenGLES, because it will be completely different than GLES1. So hopefully that cleared up some confusion. Again, that information was pretty much just for people already working with AndEngine, or they kind of dip their toes in it and are really confused about what the base extension should be. So hopefully that cleared that up. Now for everyone that has no idea about AndEngine, just forget about that stuff. Again, we're just going to be using base game activity when we're using GLES2, which is what we set up. I know we said we had to do callbacks, so let me show you how that's done first. Again, this engine options will get called automatically, and then it'll call our create resources automatically. But from this point on, we have to set the callbacks. So how we do that is within this onCreate resources, which is a method that allows us to load up our sprites or our images, load up all of our resources so they're easily accessible and available to us, so it doesn't, you know, slow down our game. After we're done with all that, again, we need to say that we are done creating our resources. So we have to do a callback, and we'll refer to this variable that we get passed in, or this parameter of PONCreateResources callback, and we're just going to say PONPON. Hit control space and it will fill it out for you. Then just hit dot, control space again, whoops, and do on create resources finished. So this is our callback. Say, hey, we already did all of our resources, or we loaded up all our resources or created all our resources, and we're done with this method. Go on to the next method, which will be our create scene method. Let's just go ahead and create a scene variable. And I'll explain what scenes are and all this stuff here in a second. Right now, I just want to show you about the callbacks. So we're going to say this scene, create new scene. And then after we've created our scene, we're going to refer it again peon and then control space dot on create scene finished. And we pass in the scene variable here, so it'll be this dot scene. So obviously this method is for creating our actual scene, and we do that and then we pass that scene into the callback as well, and that will tell our engine that we are done creating our scene. Lastly, it will populate the scene, and we do that again, I'll explain this stuff as we go through the series, but we need to do our callback. So again, it's pretty much the same concept here. So instead of these methods being called automatically, the onCreateResource method will be called automatically, but from that point on we have to say, hey, we're done with this, go on to the next method. So hopefully that makes sense. Now I kind of want to talk about what these methods mean. This is our base game activity, and like I said, the engine options will be called automatically. This is where we're going to set up, well, the options for engine. We're going to set up a camera, and I'll explain what that is in a second. We're going to set up pretty much just the camera in here. And then again, our resources will load up our textures, our bitmaps, all that stuff within our resources. And then we'll create our scene, which we kind of did here. And we'll pass that scene in and we'll say, hey, we've created the scene. And then the populate scene, this will allow us to maybe add characters to our scene, add players or add menu items to our scene as well. So that's kind of the basics of those four methods, what they mean, and now let's see how they're done. So how AndEngine works is it's an engine, it controls everything, it controls these scenes that I was talking about, and pretty much everything in AndEngine is a scene. So you have a menu scene which has menu buttons and stuff that you can click on. We'll have a game scene, we'll have, you know, a help scene, a high score scene. Everything is classified as a scene. So it's basically like this stage where you put characters on or different elements, buttons, all that stuff. Now you kind of know what a scene is. I mean, it might still be kind of confusing, but think of a scene as a place like a stage where you can put a character or a player or an enemy onto the stage. The next thing that we need to have is a camera. So the camera will say how close we want to be to the stage or how far away we want to be from the stage. And so we need to set up our camera first because everything is relative to the camera. So the camera is the most important element. Within the camera, we're going to set up a width and a height, which will pretty much define what we're looking at all times. So how far away from our scene. Let me try and explain this. So if we have a character, our main character is like 32 pixels by 32 pixels. If we say our camera width would be like a million pixels wide and a million pixels high, that means we're going to be super far away from that 32 by 32 character, and it's going to make that guy look incredibly small. So we want to have our camera closer and say the total width of our camera is going to be like 700 or 800, and the total height is going to be about 400. So that way we're pretty close to our character. We could probably fit, you know, good, I don't know, I'm not even thinking about the math right now, but probably like, you know, 30 characters in there and we'll be all right. Obviously, the camera width and camera height defines everything. If that made sense, I might edit that out because it might be kind of confusing. Anyways, we're going to create a protected static vinyl int because we don't want this to be changed. This will be our camera width. And we're going to set this equal to be like 800 or 720. You'll see often, and that's going to be the width of our scene or our camera. And then we're just going to actually copy and paste this, and we're going to refer to the camera height, and we're going to set this up to be about 480. We'll change this to be about 800. So obviously these are just integers right now, and if you guys are getting confused at the whole Java thing, you might want to check out our basic Java course or Android basics course, and it'll catch you up with kind of what's going on if you're completely new to programming. You might want to check those out first. And it looks like this tutorial is about 10 minutes, so I'm probably going to cut it off here. But in the next tutorial, we're going to set up our camera, set up maybe a sprite, show you guys that interaction as well, working with those four methods. So I know we're kind of moving slow and you guys are anxious to create your game. So trust me, this tutorial series will get faster and faster. I just wanted to make sure we cover the basics first. So thanks again for watching, guys, and we'll see you later.